Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the first ever episode of Life Bites, where we feed your brain in 50 minutes or less. My name is Nathan Isidora, and on behalf of Phillips University, I would like to thank you for attending. Our presenter today is Paul Heffner. Paul has been working for almost 30 years trying to help people understand the what, the how, and the why of lighting and energy conservation. He learned about light and lighting by doing lighting. Paul developed, implemented, and commissioned projects in both the private and public sector. Today, he provides training and education for Phillips and other clients focused on the end user. He uses engagement as the cornerstone of his training approach, so please do expect to be asked to participate today. So now, without any further ado, Paul Heffner.
Welcome to the Money of Light. So, when you propose an energy conservation solution to your customer, externally as a sales rep, an engineer, or a designer, or internally as a colleague, 9 out of 10 times, you're going to use the generic financial language of payback and ROI. It's expected. But is it connected to what matters to your customer? Suppose you did the unexpected. Suppose you surprised your customer and use the financial language that connected to how they create their income stream or their profits. Making that connection engages your customer and changes what the investment and the savings mean to them and to their business. During the balance of this 15-minute webinar, you're going to learn how to use two techniques designed to engage your customer emotionally and accelerate the time to a decision. Let's begin. Lighting and other energy conservation proposals focus on these two financial metrics. Payback, which is the incremental cost or investment divided by the first year savings, and ROI, which is the first year savings, sorry, it's not flipped upside down here, divided by the incremental cost times 100%. Payback and ROI. Typically, we treat our customers as if they were in the energy saving business, when in fact, only ESCOs, energy service companies, and utilities make their profits saving energy. Everyone else earns a profit by selling something, servicing something, serving someone, or some combination of the three. The challenge, as I see it from my work experience, is what would happen to our conversation if we translated energy savings into a financial metric that was more meaningful to our customer? Your challenge is much like making an electrical connection in another country. We need to adapt the plug so that our power supply for our computer or our shaver will work in that local socket. In the same way, we have to adapt our discussion of money to a language that connects with the customer at an emotional and motivational level. How can we do this? Well, let's start with a simple example of payback and ROI. Please get your calculators ready. So we have an investment of $25,000 and a first-year savings of $10,000. Pretty simple calculation. Divide 25 by 10, how many years will it take to get back our investment? 25 divided by 10, 2.5 years. Now, the ROI investment, we're just flipping that calculation over, and we're going to take the first year savings, $10,000, put it over $25,000, multiply it times 100%. What's our percentage ROI? 10 over 25 is 0.4 times 100%. 40% ROI. And payback and ROI calculations are quite simple. But very early in my career as a trainer in the Phillips Lighting Center in Somerset, New Jersey, I used this technique. And I don't want to say it backfired because I really learned a lot from it. And what I learned changed forever how I thought about communicating financial ideas to my customers. A supermarket chain was visiting the lighting center, and Frank, a VP for store planning and operations, arrived with his architect and four company VPs in tow to discuss light and lighting for their 325 stores. Each store had a project of about $25,000 and a savings of $10,000. Just like the discussion we just had, a payback of 2.5 years and an ROI of 40%. Well, Frank and his team immediately balked at a 2.5 year payback and a 40% ROI, saying that their store managers would lose out on their bonus for at least 6 months and more likely 9 months, and they would never, ever go along with this. They could not sell this idea internally. Well, I thought about that for a moment, and I gave Frank a calculator. So I'm going to ask you to open your calculator, and let's just do a quick calculation here. Net-net for a supermarket chain, about 1%. So here's what I asked Frank to do, and here's what I'm going to ask you to do. Enter $10,000 into the register of your calculator. Divide by a penny, or 1%. What's the answer? And that's exactly right. Yes, $1 million. That was the answer that appeared in the register. Frank, if I could show you how to put the equivalent of $1 million through the register of each and every one of your stores, could we have a more serious conversation about this? And immediately it clicked for Frank. He knew what putting $1 million through the register cost their supermarket chain. And he knew that his store managers knew what that was. This changed the context and stopped him in his tracks. Did it change the payback? No. Did it change the ROI? No. What it changed was the context of the discussion. And so we spoke this language of the customer and wound up back in their offices the very next day. We moved the project forward. Let's use another example. This time, property management. 3 million square feet, trying to get a property manager with a potential of 45 small projects within this 3 million square feet of property management. Couldn't get an appointment with the property manager, which was a first step to getting to the owner. Again, payback and ROI was 2.5 years, a $25,000 cost, $10,000 worth of savings. And we knew, though, that by taking all of the numbers, we had about a 15 cent per square foot increase in net operating income, or a 15 cent per square foot decrease in net operating expense. So even though the level of interest was very low on the payback and ROI side, a phone call to the property manager had the following consequences. I asked the property manager to plug in $3 million into the register. So if you do that, please, on your calculator, we're going to get ready to do polling question number 3. And then multiply that times 15 cents a square foot, which is the increase in net operating income or the decrease in net operating expense. What is the answer? How many dollars worth of savings will this property manager be able to deliver to the owners of the property? And the results of the poll are, yes, $450,000 is the correct answer. $450,000 is what the property manager could deliver. Now, to get the property manager's attention, it turns out that they were paid an incentive on increases in net operating income and decreases in net operating expense to the tune of about 3% over a budget number. Now, go ahead and do another calculation. Multiply $450,000 times 3%. What do you get in this answer? It turns out, while you're working on this, that the payback and ROI was really a non-starter in both instances, both in the supermarket instance and in the instance of the property manager. But finding something that mattered to the customer, that spoke a language that they understood and worked in property management, it's cost per square foot, and it made a difference in the selling process, in the communication of the value proposition to this particular customer. So there you have it, $13,500. In fact, that's what the incentive was for the property manager. Now, think about this. This is a $1,125,000 project, an investment. That sounds like a very big number. But when we look at what this can be translated to in speaking the language of the customer, let's just use one of the many ways that we can value a building. Let's use the capitalization rate. $450,000 worth of savings at a 10% capitalization rate means that we've added $4.5 million in additional value to the building. Now, how big does a $1.1 million investment seem? So the key to all of this, and the point of this webinar, is to just whet your appetite to the notion of looking at the financial aspects of engaging the customer with the supermarket, translate that payback and ROI into through the register. With property management, translate it into increases in net operating income and net operating expense. But any business has some type of financial metric. Take a look at what it is and how you can make that click with your customer, how you can make the connection. Thank you very much. Hope this has been helpful to you. Back to you, Nathan.
Thank you, Paul, for that very interesting and very interactive presentation. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have any questions, now's the time to ask them. Paul will read them out and answer them as best he can. And if you don't have any questions, I hope you enjoyed the presentation and look forward to the next Light Bites.
There's a question about incremental cost and the formula. There are two ways of doing it. The incremental cost is the typical way in energy conservation that we use because there was an alternative investment, something else that you would be spending money on. But sometimes the customer requires that it be done as a total investment. In this instance, I should have been clear on that. The total investment was $25,000. And that was what was actually going on in that first thing. Good question. Nice catch. Thank you. Okay. There's also a question here. Can you please give me a quick resume about the supermarket case, please? How did you say you engaged your client? My audio cut out. Basically, the client was in the lighting center for a presentation on light and lighting and how to improve the look and feel of the supermarket. Which is my primary concern, but what I wanted to do was to get the customer to get emotionally involved in it, and by using the 1% net, in other words, their net profit going through the register was about 1% of sales. And so by dividing the $10,000 savings by the 1% net profit, it's the equivalent of having sold $1 million worth of groceries through the register. And so that's what we did with this particular customer. Thank you for that question. And there's one last one here. Let me just see if I can. Can we put this in a document that we can use as a tool when we meet with different customers? You most certainly can. In fact, but you have to get the customer to talk with you and help you to understand how they talk about money. So long as you understand what it is that's important to them, what they value in this conversation, you certainly want to use that in your proposal, because very often, I think you'll all agree, we're very often not in the room when the final presentation is made. Okay. Another question is, Can we include depreciation costs? Okay, this is just a simple tool for a 15-minute webinar. There are many, many, many financial tools that can be used in a presentation. The key is what matters to your customer. If they want to understand it in terms of net present value or internal rate of return, or if they want to see what the depreciation is for tax effect situations, certainly that would be a valuable thing. And actually, Nathan, that might be an interesting webinar one day. Let's see. No, every customer, what we should do. Oh, okay. If this is interesting to know, but I've got different kinds of customers, and what should we do? There are examples that you could use for healthcare. There are examples you can use for manufacturing. It depends on what it is you're focused on. In working with a manufacturer, sometimes we'll talk about the cost of safety. What is one lost time accident? What does that cost a company? And then translate it into those things. But you've got to get the customer to do what's called self-documented proof statements. In other words, if you try to tell them, well, it's going to operate, you're going to operate more safely in the environment, that doesn't get you anywhere, because then you've got to prove that. But if the customer, after you put in a demonstration, says the workforce has indicated that they are working more productively, or that they feel like they can operate their forklift safer, now you have the customer's self-documented proof statement, and that can work. And there are many other examples. So working with hospitals and healthcare, the cost of replacing an RN has something to do with the safety in the parking deck next to the hospital. I mean, there's a lot of different ways that you can take these ideas and translate them. And I think we're pretty much out of time for today, but okay, let me just see here. Supermarkets, so they would have to sell an extra $1 million for them to make the same amount of, yes, that is correct. The question is, so they would have to sell an extra $1 million of product to make the same amount as this project would save. Is that what you're saying? Yes, that's exactly what I'm saying. And that's why Frank got so excited once we put it in that term. This is not referring to, the question is this referring to LED lighting? No, this was, I don't want to tell you how many years ago this was. This was 12 years ago that this happened. There was no way we were doing LED at that time. Would it be possible to put together what you call the financial cell and outline all of these methods? I'm not prepared to do that at this point, but we certainly look at that. I'll talk with the university about that. Nathan, I think that's all of the questions. There's a request for a PDF copy of the webinar. I don't know if you do that.
Yes, Paul. We usually do not send a PDF or a PPT version of the webinar out. We do provide the recording to the webinar that everybody can view at their own leisure. It will be online on YouTube, and the link will be sent out.
Okay.
So, Paul, I'd like to thank you for giving us this presentation and answering all these questions. I assume the people enjoyed it very, very much.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity to be of service and to share this these ideas. And thanks very much. Everybody have a great day.
Okay. Thank you, Paul. And thank you, everyone, for attending.